And here to address the United Nations, President Mugabe joins me now in the studio. So welcome to this program. Thank you for coming in. What are you going to ask? Are you going to ask President Obama to lift the sanctions that are imposed?
No, really. I haven't come here for President Obama to address the United States alone. I've come here to address the General Assembly, which is part of the United Nations structures. And we are entitled to discuss matters that affect us in the global environment, and then matters that affect us in a particular way as Zimbabwe. And this is what I'm going to do.
So you obviously are calling for sanctions to be lifted.
Yes, that I will do, certainly. Mm-hmm. The sanctions are unjustified, they are illegal, and they are meant for regime change to address that illegal principle.
You say for regime change, but it all really is about trying to get the political situation stabilized. And for the last year, you've been in a so-called power-sharing agreement with the leader of the opposition, Morgan Tsvangirai. What does power-sharing to you mean? Many people say that it's in name only right now.
No, it is really power-sharing. And that power-sharing is encapsulated in an agreement we call the Global Political Agreement. And this was arrived at through the facilitation that we got from South Africa, and specifically through the facilitation by former President Thabo Mbeki.
The problem, though, is, Mr. President, that many people are saying that you're still, and your party is trying to sort of reduce the MDC majority or their officials in parliament. There are MPs who are being arrested, they're being charged with alleged crimes to prevent them from being able to take office. Why is this still happening?
First, may I make this quite clear, that the global political agreement was arrived at after a series of meetings which involved not just ZANU-PF, as represented by myself and our negotiators, but also between ZANU-PF and the MDC, as represented by Tsvangirai and Professor Mtambara and their negotiators.
Right.
And these provisions in the global agreement were reached after very strenuous discussions had taken place.
Right, but
they were not forced upon us.
No, but the question
we came to them deliberately.
All right.
We arrived at them deliberately.
All right, so if you say you arrived at them deliberately, why then are their MPs and officials still being harassed?
The issue of those who have been arrested is a different matter altogether. Some of them had committed crimes before the global agreement. Crimes such as rape and kidnapping. You couldn't let people who have committed such crimes get away with merely because there is a global agreement.
Has Roy Bennett committed a crime? Why is he not being sworn in?
Roy Bennett has been charged. And on the face of it, the charges are very serious. But I'm told, and I'm told this by the leader of the MDC, that the prosecution is adducing no evidence. There are no witnesses. And I've said, if there are no witnesses, the prosecution will arrive at a time when they will say so.
So charged with
but
what?
Let's not read that for them. Let them read that conclusion.
Do you think that
on
he
their
will?
Own.
Do you think that he'll be
I have
appointed?
Said, yes. If he's acquitted,
but charged
he will be
with what?
Charged with having, you know, tried to put. I think he was found responsible for. That's the allegation. The allegation is that he's responsible for organizing arms of war against Zimbabwe.
Well, we'll obviously have to ask him about that.
These are the charges that are being made on the face of them.
Well,
but if the prosecution cannot prove that in fact he did so, that in fact he's guilty of, you know, trying to organize, you know.
Mr. Mugabe, that's certainly the first I'm hearing of it, and we will obviously put that to them. But can I say this? There are a lot of people, and you heard in that report, who considered you an African hero back in 1980, that you came, and some of my own friends, Rhodesians, some of the people I've worked with who were in the Rhodesian army, then became journalists in Rhodesia, were stunned by the conciliatory nature and the addresses that you gave back in 1980.
Yes.
And describe how for 10 years your policies led to prosperity, led to successes in mining, in agriculture, in all sorts of things. And then over the last 10 years, things have really gone south in a big and bad way. Why is it that's happened?
Over the last 10 years.
Reform, and remember that the presidents of Mozambique and Tanzania, when you took the country to liberation, said to you that you have the jewel of Africa in your hands, now look after it.
Yes, we are looking.
Did you look after it?
Yes, in a very great way. Over the last 10 years, we have had Zidera, the sanctions imposed on us by the United States, plus sanctions imposed upon us by the European Union over the last 10 years.
Right, but they were specifically targeted sanctions against individuals, not against the
Zimbabwe
trade or development.
No. The United States sanctions on us are real sanctions, economic sanctions. Have you looked at them? Look at them and you will satisfy yourselves that they prevent companies from having any dealings with us.
But they're very specifically targeted.
They prevent any financial institutions.
But how do you account, for these incredible statistics where since you took over, life expectancy has dropped,
but
manufacturing has fallen.
But I'm just telling you, the reasons. It's because of sanctions mainly.
But everybody says it's not because of sanctions, it's because of mismanagement.
Not everybody says so.
Most people do, most independent observers say that.
In Zimbabwe, it's not true.
How to get out of this now? How to get out of this? Do you think, for instance,
sanctions must be lifted, and we should have no interference from outside. The continued imperialist interference in our affairs is affecting the country adversely.
I would like to play one soundbite by a neighbor of yours, a Nobel Peace Prize winner, Archbishop Desmond Tutu, who said the following.
He's destroyed a wonderful country, a country that used to be a bread basket. It has now become a basket case itself. But I think now, that the world must say, look, you have been responsible with your cohorts. You have been responsible for gross violations, and you are going to face indictment in The Hague unless you step down.
How do you respond to that? First, that you've taken the breadbasket of Africa into a basket case?
No, it's not a basket case at all. Last year, we managed to grow enough food for ourselves. We are not a basket case anymore.
One in 14 people are called malnourished. Your country is practically dependent on humanitarian aid.
You're not talking of the present.
I know things have got slightly better in the last year.
They have got much better in terms of food. People have grown enough food for themselves. We have had years. Continuous, successive years of drought. Don't forget that.
I've seen the drought figures. I've got all the statistics
sanctions
here
as well.
Yeah.
And combine the effects of drought with the effects of sanctions, and what do you get?
Well, and the effect of what many people are saying is the land reform that really created this huge discrepancy in your ability to farm. We're going to go to a break, and we'll talk about that when we come back, all right?
No, yes, but the land reform is the best thing that could ever
The best thing?
Yes, that could ever have happened to an African country.
We will talk about it in a second.
It has to do with national sovereignty.
Okay, let's talk about it in a second.